Okay, hello again. This is Dr. Lindsay. In this video, what I'd like to do is go over the total surplus changes in a monopoly market as compared to a perfectly competitive market, and then go over the topic of price discrimination. So first, let's take a look at a perfectly competitive market and review again what total surplus is. So we've got this supply curve upward sloping, demand curve downward sloping. In equilibrium, we have Q star that's produced and a price of P star. Everything below the demand curve and above the price is the consumer surplus. And everything above the supply curve below the price is the producer surplus. And this market is efficient because we're maximizing total surplus. But what about under monopoly? Is total surplus maximized under monopoly? Now we know it's maximized here under perfect competition because anyone that buys this product values it more than the marginal cost of producing it. But that's not true in monopoly. Now here is a monopoly, and I've got the demand curve and the marginal revenue curve here, as well as the marginal cost curve here. And in this case, the monopolist is going to set a quantity Q star down here, and a price, we'll call it P star here. And they're able to capture some of the producers, the consumer surplus. Because of the higher price, there's less consumer surplus in this market. So monopolist is able to capture some of that. But there's a problem here in that the quantity, not only is the price higher than monopolist, but the quantity is less. And if we look at this little triangle right here, I'll draw it in black. This is a loss of surplus. It's called a dead weight loss. There's some inefficiencies in the market here with a monopolist. So you see inside that triangle, there are those that value this product at a greater price than the cost of producing it, the marginal cost of producing it, but yet it's not produced and sold because the monopolist doesn't want to produce it because then he'd have to, or she would have to lower the price of their product for anyone that was paying the higher price, P star. So we end up with this little triangle here that's just considered a dead weight loss, and it's a loss of surplus in the market that makes this market inefficient. Now, monopolists, the price will be higher than a competitive perfectly competitive market, and there'll be profits. But there's a way that a monopolist can actually increase the profit even more. And that's with something called price discrimination. So the monopolist has this demand curve, marginal revenue curve, marginal cost curve, and produces right here where the marginal cost equals the marginal revenue. And then we go up here and charge this price, this monopoly price. And that will maximize their profit. And everybody is paying P superscript M. But we've got people that would actually like to buy the product at a little lower price, and the monopolist could make it at a cheaper price. So it'd be nice to sell it to those people, but sell it to them for a lower price. But you can't lower your price because then you got to lower the price for everybody else. But wouldn't it be nice, though, to charge several prices for this product? Charge a really high price, even higher than the monopoly price, to those that would value it the most up there at the top part of the demand curve. And then have a regular monopoly price for the rest. And then maybe a price that's even a little bit lower for those that don't want to pay that monopoly price, but are still willing to pay a price that's greater than the marginal cost. Charging different groups different prices is called price discrimination. And it's a way to increase the price for the monopolist. So if you think about it here, well, how about, what if the monopolist was able to, if this is Q star here, what if they were able to take the first half that they produced, this quantity here, Q star divided by 2, and sell it to these people way up on the demand curve? And we'll call that price H, high price, higher than monopoly price. Charge them PH, and then the rest of the quantity, charge them PM, the monopolist charge price. And that way we could capture more of the consumer surplus. We could get all this consumer surplus. Now, the more we can charge different prices to different people, the more consumer surplus that can be captured by the monopolist. We can even get rid of the dead weight loss by capturing that too, by charging a lower price to people that are down in that area. The difficulty is, how do you charge two different prices for the same product, or three different prices for the same product? It's not particularly easy to keep the group separate. But companies try to do this to increase their profit. You've somehow got to charge one group one price, another group another price, and make sure the two groups can't sell their products to each other. So business has been doing this for a long time. Take the airlines. They know that they've got two different types of customers. They have the business customer who is willing to pay a pretty big price for flying. And then they have the vacation traveler that's not willing to pay such a high price. And they want to be able to charge the business travelers more. How do you do that? Well, they'll do things like, if you stay over the weekend, Saturday night, you can get a lower price on the ticket. And they know that the business travelers don't want to spend the weekend where they're going and staying overnight. The vacationers do. So by having some tickets that are much cheaper but require a Saturday night stayover, allows them to charge two different prices for the ticket. A lower price for the vacation traveler and a higher price for the business traveler. Another way to do it might be something like a senior discount, offering them 10% less. The reason is because their demand curve is different because they don't have as much money. Or a student discount, same thing. The demand curve for the students is going to be a little bit less because as a group, they don't have as much money as the non-students. Wineries do it. Some wineries, they'll have another label, not the name of their winery, but some other label that they sell at a lower price. Maybe the quality is a little bit inferior, maybe not. A winery not too far from here is the Tally Winery. And they also make another kind of wine there. with another label, maybe the same wine, but a different label called Bishop's Peak. And it's a lot cheaper than the wine that says Tally on it. Castoral Winery in Paso Robles does something kind of similar. Their wines are about $25 a bottle. So here's one of their bottles. They're at least $25 a bottle or so for their wine. I'm sure it's a lot greater than their marginal cost. If you go over to Trader Joe's, they have another brand. It's called Trader Joe's Coastal Winery. And it's about $5 a bottle. And if you look on the back, it says vinted and bottled by Castoro Cellars. So we got the one with the Castoro name on it for $25, and we got the Coastal for $5. And if you go over to the winery and ask them, what's the difference between the two? They'll tell you, well, it's the same grapes on the same land, harvested the same way. And the vintage process is the same. The only difference is the wine sold to Trader Joe's may not be sitting in the oak barrels as long. Maybe it's only 6 months or 3 months, and the one with their name on it might be sitting in the oak barrels for a year and a half or 2 years. Okay, so it might be a little bit inferior, but what they've managed to do is charge two different prices for their products. And I've opened up both of them, same year, same grape, poured it for people. And my circle of friends, they can't tell the difference at all between them. Except one's $25 a bottle, one's $5 a bottle. Now, why doesn't Castoro go ahead and sell this one? Why don't they put their name on this one and sell it for five? Well, they can't. That means that they would have to sell this one for five instead of 25, and it's not going to be as profitable. Universities and colleges price discriminate. It might be surprising. How do they tell the different demand by their students? Well, there's a financial aid form. You have to fill out your income and wealth for whoever's paying the college bill. And of course, with a normal good, which college is, the more income you have and wealth, the more you're willing to pay for it. So they can look at individual students and see who is willing to pay more than others to go to their college. And those that aren't willing to pay as much, give them a discount on the price. Some are just blatantly, they say, hey, the price of the college is based upon your income. Most of them will say, we'll give you a scholarship. And the scholarship really is based upon income. They'll say it's based upon grades or academic, but really what it is just meeting a minimum level of achievement, GPA. And then it's really based upon income as to how much a student is given to go to, is charged really for their tuition. Appliances companies do it. Whirlpool, they make their wash machines and appliances. They also make a much cheaper model called Roper. Doesn't have as many bells and window whistles on it, but it's just as good quality. It's the same machinery, really made by Whirlpool, but it's substantially cheaper. Another way that companies try to price discriminate is by giving volume discounts. So the first one costs $20. You buy two for $18. That means really the second one costs $8. And if you buy three, it's $25. Which means the third one is $7. and so on. The more you buy, the cheaper it is. Now, why are they doing this? They're essentially charging you a higher price for the first one than the second one and the third one, because the demand curve is downward sloping. They know you're willing to pay more for the first one than the fourth or fifth one. Some of the clothing manufacturers, retailers do it all also. You buy one, it's a certain price. Buy two, it's another price. Sometimes they say you have to buy two to get the price. But one thing I'm pretty sure of, by the time you get down to the sixth one and it's much, much cheaper, it's still greater than the marginal cost of producing one of those units. Now, there's something called a perfectly discriminating monopolist. That's a monopolist that's able to charge each buyer the price that is the most they would be willing to pay for it. So a different price for every single buyer, which means if they do that, they can collect the entire consumer surplus. So if here's the demand curve, and here's the marginal cost curve, all this surplus, consumer surplus up here, can be captured. In fact, they can even capture all the surplus that would be dead weight loss too, because they can keep charging a lower and lower price all the way down to where the price is greater than their marginal cost. So price discrimination allows to charge different prices to different groups, and those that value it more charge them more money, and it increases the profit of the monopolist. The extreme case is where the monopolist charges the maximum price to every single buyer as to what they would be willing to pay by the demand curve, and collects the entire consumer surplus, turns that into a producer surplus.